Good evening, everyone, and welcome to today's session on Python programming. Good evening, Jini ma'am.
Good evening.
Ma'am, I have given you the right so that you can start.
Okay, sure. Thank you. Yes, is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am, visible.
Okay. So, if you have any doubt in between, you can ask. So, we are going to today discuss the NumPy library. So, NumPy library is a Python library that is specially used to work with the arrays, right? So, it can solve linear algebra problems and many other problems. It is an open source library and it is freely available. So NumPy here stands for numerical Python, right? So it is mostly used for numerical purposes and especially used for arrays. So why we use this? Because this library is very fast as compared to lists and other types of libraries, and it has various supporting functions that we can use. So it is very important library, and it is most used ones library from the Python list of libraries. So we'll start discussing this library. I am running the codes on the Jupyter notebook using the Anaconda environment. So you can run on this also, or you can use any other Google Collab. You can also use, you can use online platform also. So I'm running on Jupyter notebook, right? So first of all, it's installing NumPy library. So most of the times NumPy library is pre-installed in your environment. So what you can do is you can try importing the NumPy library first. And if you get the error that you don't have the NumPy environment, then you can install it using pip install NumPy command, right? So this is the command that we can use to install the NumPy library if suppose you don't have a supporting NumPy background with you. So pip install NumPy. If you are using Anaconda, so you can open the Anaconda prompt, and from there you can type pip install NumPy and it will install the latest version with you, and you can start using that library. So its installation is quite simple. Next is before using the library, we have to import it in an environment. So to import the library, the command is import NumPy. So we are using the import. NumPy is the name of the library, as we are using for the aliasing, right? Aliasing here means that instead of every time when you want to call any function from the NumPy library, instead of writing it completely, you can give it any name that would be easy to use, right? So you can give any name to it, any alias to it, just like I have used np here. So whenever I want to use any function or anything inside the NumPy library, I don't have to call every time that library with the full name. I can use the alias of that name. So to import that, I am using import NumPy as np. You can give any name to it, right? So you can see that the first line has run. It means that our NumPy library has been imported and we can start using it functionality, right? So the most important thing in the NumPy library is the arrays, though it is specifically used for the arrays. So it is very easy to build an array here to do the manipulations on the arrays. So we are going to start with the arrays, and first of all we are going to deal with the 1D arrays, right? So how we can generate the 1D arrays? Initially, what you can do is you can give it a list of numbers that you want inside your array, right? Just like I have given here, you can give any name to it, like arr list, and inside that I am providing the list of numbers that I want inside my array. So you can use any numbers, and number of numbers you can give inside it, or you can also take it from the user also. So you can take the list from the list of numbers from the users, to then you can convert it into the array, right? So I'm defining here a list that consists of three numbers, 10, 20, and 30. So if I run this, it has been run. So if I print this array list, you can see that it is a list. How we can see that it is a list? It can be seen from this square bracket. So square bracket tells us that it is of the list type, right? So it is a list that consists of three numbers, that is 10, 20, and 30. Now what we need is we need to convert it into an array. So to convert it into an array, we are going to use a function dot array from the NumPy library. So we are using NumPy library as np, right? So from that NumPy np dot inside that, we are calling a function that is array. So it's a direct function array which converts our list into the array. So inside this, we are going to pass our list that we have created, and it will directly convert it into a 1D array, right? So if I run this and run this again, so now you can see initially it was a list that consists of three elements, that is 10, 20, and 30. Now it is an array that consists of list of numbers, right? So it is as simple to convert, to build an array here. So we can take the list from the user input also, or we can manually define the list, and then we can use the dot array function directly from the NumPy library, and it will convert it into an array, right? So we can also check the shape of the array, that whether it is a 1D array or 2D array or anything. So for that, we are using the dot shape function. So for that, we'll give the name of the variable whose shape we want to see, and dot shape, it will give us the shape of the NumPy array that we have. So you can see it is giving us a value 3 comma. So what does this mean? That it consists of a three elements and it is only one dimensional. That is why the second argument is empty here, right? So this is the way we can define the 1D arrays. Similar to the 1D arrays, we can also define the 2D arrays also, right? So for the 2D arrays, what we can do is, so you can see here, 2D array is like a matrix, right? So 2D array is a matrix. We can build a matrix of any shape. So I am building here a matrix. So for that, what I am taking is, matrix is type of a list that consists of further list, right? So it consists of rows and columns. So it means that it is a list of lists. So I am defining a list here, that is the outer braces. These braces, these are the outer ones that tells us that we have a list. Inside that, I have defined four lists. It means it is a list of list, right? So this is a way of defining 2D arrays. So we are creating here the list of list. So you can see here that we have the outer list that consists of the lists inside it. So now we need to convert this list of list into a 2D array. So for that, again, we are going to use the dot array function that is defined in the NumPy library. And inside that, we are going to give out the list of the list, and it will convert for us into an array, right? So if I am going to run this, so you can see that it has converted our list of the list into a 2D array that consists of four rows and three columns. So you can see here that we have four lists here. So four lists here tells us how many rows we want, and inside each row how many columns we want, right? So this is a way of defining a 2D array. So the array defining is quite simple here, as you can see. In this way you can define nd arrays, right? N dimensional arrays you can define depending upon the requirement, right? So we are going to discuss 1D arrays, 2D arrays, and 3D arrays. These three, up till 3D arrays are quite common to use. Above that, we don't use it usually. So it depends upon the particular problem in hand. So if we want, we can have ND arrays with us, right? So there is another function that is dtype. It tells us the type of the array we are using, So if I'm going to run this, so you can see that it is giving us the type that it is int 32. What this means is that the element inside an array is a all the elements inside the array are of type int 32. So it means we have integer values of 32 bits, right? So these are the way of defining 2D arrays. Similar to the 2D arrays, we can also have the 3D arrays, right? So I'm going to give you an example of a 3D array also. So you can see that it was a 2D array was a list of lists, right? So here, sorry. So it is, here it is list of lists, right? So it is an initial list that is for the first one. Then it consists of another list that is for the 2D, and then it consists of inside list that consists of the elements inside that. So it means we are building a 3D array here. So if I'm going to run this, so you can see here I am directly converting these lists into the array. So either you can directly convert it into a list or into an array, or you can first define the list and then you can convert it into an array using np.array function, right? So you can see here that it is a 3D array. So to make it sure that it is a 3D array, you can also set the shape of the array. So if I'm running this, so you can see that it consists of 2, 2, 3, that it is a 3D array. So you have to visualize it in the 3D, that how the array is defined, right? So above the 3D arrays, it is very difficult to visualize. That is why I'm discussing only up to 3D arrays. So in the similar fashion, you can have ND arrays, and depends upon the problem at hand, right? So in this way, you can directly use the arrays, right? So the function that is we have to call from the library is np.array function, right? And the other function is np.shape. So it tells us the shape of the array, that whether it is a 1D array, 2D array, or a 3D array, right? And there is another function that is dtype. It gives us the what type of values are there inside an array, right? So we have used three functions up till now. Next, the most important thing after the arrays is the reshaping of the arrays. Sometimes we need to reshape one type of the array into the other type, right? So I'm going to show you how we are going to reshape the arrays. So let's suppose we have an array here that is a 2D array that consists of list inside the list, and inside that we have three columns here, and so on. So it means it consists of four rows, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So it consists of four rows and three columns, right? So, and first of all, we have defined it inside a list. Then you can convert it into an array using np.array function, right? And we are going to just run this. So you can see here that I have also checked the dtype here to show you what int32 meant was. So you can see here that some of the values here are floating type, right? 10.02, 9.13. So these tell us that some of the values are floating point. So what it does is implicitly converts all the values to the type of floating point. So the data type will be float 64. So it will be floating point values represented by 64 bits. So you can also see here that how our array looks. So if I run this, so you can see here that it consists of floating point values, two floating point values. Now you can also see that initially here it was 20. It has been converted into 20 point. It means that it has been implicitly converted into a value of 20.00. So if any one or more than one of the elements floating point, So it implicitly converts all the values to a floating point values, right? So you can see here easily. So it consists of 3 rows and 4 columns. So if I check the shape of this, it should be 3, 4, right? So first the number of rows, 4, 3, right? So it means it consists of 4 rows and 3 columns. So I'm going to reshape it. Let's suppose I want it to be a 6, 2. It means I want 6 rows and only 2 values per row, right? So I'm going to, so for that, we are going to directly use the reshape function. So the array that originally we have of 4, 3, then dot reshape is a function that we are going to use. And inside it, we are going to pass on the parameter that what shape we want our array to be changed to, right? If I run this, so you can see here that it has been converted into an array. And one more thing to note that by reshaping the array, it has converted it into the integer type of array. So it has cut down all the values that were in the floating point, right? So you can see that first 2 values have become the first rows, 3rd and 4th value has become the second row, and so on. So in this way, you can convert your array into the any shape that you want. Now, the second thing is about the reshaping is that you have to utilize all the elements inside your array that you have initially, and you cannot give the dimensions such that it does not does not include the values that we have in the array, or the values that you are requiring are more, but the actual values that are presented are very less, right? For example, we can have 2, 6 type, so it means it will be a 2 rows and 6 columns. Now suppose I try to convert it into 3, 3, so it will give us an error that we cannot reshape the array of size 12 into 3, 3. Why? Because initially the elements were 4, 3. It means that 12 elements were there, and we are trying to convert those 12 elements into the shape of 3, 3. It means we wanted to have 9 elements out of it. So it is not possible. So while reshaping, we have to make sure that we have to keep the size of the array same while reshaping, right? So these were the basics of the 1D, 2D, 3D array and how to reshape those arrays to the required form. Anybody having any doubt till here? Yes, any student want to ask anything? So if you are not having any doubts, we can continue. So these were the arrays that we were building on our own, that is either through the user input or you can manually define it, right? So apart from these type of arrays, there are some inbuilt arrays also that can be used directly, right? So the first one are the zeros array. So what it does is we can directly call it using the library name, that is np.zeros. What it does is it gives us the array that consists of all the elements as 0, right? So if I run this, so you can see that we have given only one single parameter inside of it, that is 5. So it means it will give us a one-dimensional array that consists of 5 elements, and all the 5 elements would be 0, right? So in this way, you can create an array that consists of all the zeros. So why we can use these type of arrays? So for example, we have a very large array and we want to fill only some of the values and rest all the values are zero. So So instead of manually defining all the values as zero, we can initially get an array that consists of all the zeros, and then we can populate the values that we want inside it, right? So these type of arrays are useful there. So like the 1D zero array, we can also have a 2D array also. So inside that, what you have to give is, you have to give the two parameters, that is the shape of the array you want. First is number of rows and second is the number of columns. So if I am giving a 5,5, it means I am giving 5 rows and 5 columns and all the elements will be zero. Similar to that, we can have any type of zeros array. For example, I have taken here 3,5. So it means I want 3 rows and 5 columns. So in this way, we can have an array that consists of all the zeros in one dimensional, two dimension, and you can also then extend it to the MD arrays, right? Similar to the zeros arrays, we have another type of array that are dot ones. So these give us the array that consists of all the elements as one, right? So for that, using the library np, inside that we are going to use an inbuilt function, that is ones, O-N-E-S, and inside that we have to pass the arguments in the similar way as we have passed with the zero array, right? So if we are going to give a single input in a single argument inside it, it means it will give us a 1D array that consists of the 5 elements, and each of the element will be 1. In the similar fashion, we can have the 2D arrays also that consist of all the elements as 1. Like we have given 5,5, it means we will have 5 rows and 5 columns. And you can have the, apart from square matrix, you can have rectangular matrix also. So it will be, for example, you have given a value 3,5. So it will give us the 3 rows and 5 columns, and all the values will be 1. Right, so these were the two arrays, zeros and ones, that consist of all the elements either as zero or as one. So similar to these, the third most commonly used type of inbuilt array is the IEYE. So what it does is it gives us the identity array, right? So if I run this, so you can see that all the diagonal elements are one and rest of all the elements are zero. So we know that identity matrix is always a square matrix. So inside this, we only have to give the one input and it will give us a 2D array. So why it is giving us a 2D array? Because identity matrix is always a square matrix, right? So in this way, we can have a square matrix of identity values. Next is another type of array we can build using the arrange function, A-R-A-N-G-E. So what it does it, so if I am running it 5 to 50, it means that it will give us an array that consists of values from 5 till 50, where the lower bound is included, but the upper bound is not included. So in the Python, most of the time the upper bound is not included. So it means it will give us a value from 5 to 49. So if I want 50 to be included, right, if I want 50 to be included, then I have to run till 5 up till 51 so that 50 can be included. Like here, I have written 5,51. It means the value will range from 5 till 50. Right, so we can have the instead of defining the arrays manually, I suppose I want first 100 arguments. So I don't need to define the array manually. I can use the arrange function. I can give the starting range. I can give the ending range, and it will give me an array. Now, sometimes we want the array that are multiple of something, right? We don't want every element in the array. Suppose we want only the multiples of 5 in the array, right? So in that, we are going to give the third element that is going to tell us that what skip we want in our values to be. So we want a skip of 5 in the values. So it means that it will give us a value, starting value from 5 till 50, but 50 is not included, that it means 5 to 49, and it will give us the multiples of 5, So it will 5, 10, 15, 20, up till 45. Why 50 is not included here? Because the values were ranging from 5 to 49. So if I want 50 to be included here, so in the similar fashion, we are going to start from 5 till 51 and add the skip count here. So you can add anything here. You can add 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, any skip count you can add here, and it will give us the required array. So you don't have to define these type of arrays manually. So these type of arrays can be handled by using the inbuilt functions, right? Any doubt in the inbuilt functions? Yes, anybody? Any doubt? So moving on further from the inbuilt arrays, we are going to discuss the random arrays. These are the most used arrays apart from this commonly used ones. So in the random array, what we want, we normally want our arrays to be randomly consisting of the random values instead of the values starting from 1 to 50. Sometimes we want our arrays to have the random values. So NumPy has a function, a class inside of it that is random class, and it gives us the functionality to define the random arrays using the inbuilt functions. We don't have to use different types of guessing methods or anything else. You can just use the inbuilt class and we can work on that. So how to define that class? So from the NumPy library, we are importing a class, right? So to write that, how we are going to write it, from which library we want? From the NumPy library, but I want to import a class that is random, and we can define an alias to it. That is how I'm going to call this random class. So I'm going to call it as R, right? So in this way, you can define your random class. So how we can import it? From NumPy, we want the random class. So from NumPy, import random as the aliasing that you want to give it, right? So suppose, let's discuss about these random arrays. Let's suppose we want random values between 0 and 1, right? So instead of giving the values manually, you can use this class r.rand, random function that is there, rand. Inside that you have to give how many values you want between 0 and 1. I have written here 10, so it will give me 10 values between 0 and 1 that are randomly assigned. Suppose if I run this, the initial values, you can check 0.282. if I run this again, so you can see the values have been changed, right? So it is randomly assigning the value. In this way, you can have the random guesses. Like you can see the values are again changed. If I run this again, the values will again change. So we have the random 10 random values in the range from 0 to 1. So you can see it is a 1D array. In the similar fashion, we can also have a 2D array that consists of random values between 0 and 1. So we are going to use the same function rand. And inside that, we are going to define the two dimensions that we want. Like for example, I want a 5 cross 5 array that consists of random values between 0 and 1. So if I run this, you can see that we have 5 rows, 5 columns, and all the values are between 0 and 1 and random. So if I run this again, so you can see all the values have been changed and the values are randomly assigned. So after the random values, there are other types of arrays also that gives us the standard normal distributed data. So it gives us the random value, but the values will be normally distributed. So for that, we are going to use a function randn. Right? So n here stands for normal distribution. So if I run this, you can see that we have 10 values that are normally distributed. So you can see we here have negative values also. So if you will plot these values, you will get to know that these are the normally distributed values. So you have got that random values array that consists of values between 0 and 1. Suppose we want random integers inside our array, right? So we want n random integers to be there inside the array. So for that, there is another function, rand int, it stands for that we want random integer values. And inside that we are giving 10. It means I want 10 random integer. Sorry. It means that I want one random integer value starting from 0 till 10. Right? So the value that will be randomly chosen will be in the range from 0 to 10. Right? So if I run this again, so you can see the value is 2. If I run this again, so you can see the value is again randomly assigned 2, right? We can have any random value, right? Now the value has been changed to 1. So it means it randomly assigned a value, one value randomly assigned integer that should be less than or equal to 10, right? So 10 here is included or not? So 10 here is not included. Why? Because upper bound is not included in the Python functions, right? So it will give us a value from 0 to 9, but 10 is not included, right? Now similarly, I want a value between certain range, not from starting from 0, but between certain range. So we can also define that. Suppose I want a value between 10 to 100, where 100 is not included here. So for that, I'm going to give the lower range and I'm going to give the upper range, right? And it will give me a random value that is between 10 till 99, where 100 is not included, right? So if I run this, you can see that I have got a value 60 here. If I run this again, now I've got a value 47. So the value will range from 10 till 99. Now you can see that I have a value 86, 69. So values will change, but will stay in the range from 10 till 99, right? So now instead of a single value, suppose I want multiple values. For that, you are going to add your third argument to it, and the third argument will tell us that how many values we want. So you can see here that I want the values in between range 10 to 99, 100 is not included, and I want 10 random numbers in this range. So 5 random numbers in this range. So I'm going to add a 5, third argument, that is 5, and it will give me 5 values randomly assigned. So if I run this again, you can see that all the 5 values have changed accordingly, right? If I run this again, so you can see that I have a value 91, 88, 78, but 100 is not there, right? So these were the random values that we, random arrays that we can have. Any doubt? Yes, anybody, any doubt? So if you are not replying, as I am assuming that everything is clear and you don't have any doubt, right? So moving on further, after random values, there are some statistical parameters also that we can directly use from the NumPy library. So for that, I'm supposed initializing some random 10 random integers in between range 10 to 99. I'm going to run this. So you can see that I have 10 values. Now I want the maximum value out of it. So you don't have to apply any loop to it. You can directly use dot max function and it will give us a maximum value that is present inside the array. So you can see the maximum value that is present here is 90. So in this way, we can directly use a function dot max and it will give us the maximum value. And similarly, we can also have a minimum value. So dot min function using dot min function. you can see that minimum value here is 30. So it is randomly from the random array, we can have the minimum value, maximum value. Similarly to that, we can have a mean value also. So what it does, it will give the mean of all these values, right? So it will sum up these values and divide by 10 and give us the mean. If you can check that it is giving mean correctly or not. Is my voice proper now? So after mean value, we can have a standard deviation also. I think now it should be clear. Okay, so after mean, we can have a standard deviation also. We can calculate the standard deviation in the data also. For that, we are going to use the STD function. So STD function gives us the standard deviation of the data. So if you are going to calculate the standard deviation, it will come out to be 23.366, right? In the similar fashion, you can also have other statistical parameters that are most commonly used. So I have discussed the most commonly used ones, that is the maximum of the array, minimum of the array, mean of the array, standard deviation of the array. So in this way, you can have other types of statistical parameters also. You can try and test and check what other statistical parameters are present, right? So these were the statistical parameters. Next is index slicing and indexing. Slicing and indexing is very important part of the array manipulation. So please listen to this carefully. And if you have any doubt, you can ask in between also. So slicing and indexing means that I have, suppose, an array and I want to have some part of it and not the complete array, right? So we are going to slice or index some part of the array, right? So for that, I am randomly assigning using randin function. I am randomly getting 10 values that are in between the range 10 to 99, right? So if I run this, so you will get the 10 values here. So you can see that all these values are in the range from 10 till 99 and 100 is not included. So I have taken the 10 values out of here. So suppose I want the value at the 8th index, right? So for that, what I am going to use is I am going to take the name of the variable that we have defined inside the square brackets. I am going to define the index for which value I want, right? So if I am going to run this, so you will get the value that is present at 8th index. Now the indexing in the arrays in the Python start from 0. So if I want the 8th index, it means it will give me the 9th value, right? So starting from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So at 8th index, the value is 89. Right, so you can get the indexing in this way. You can get the any value out of the array using the index of that value, right? So now suppose I want the some lists out of that array, not complete array, but some lists out of it and not a single element. So I can slice some part of the array also, right? To slice the array, what you have to do is you have to define the starting range of the slicing and the ending range of the slicing. Let for example, I am slicing from the index 1 till index 6, where 6 is not included, right? So this will be the index 1, that is 66. This will be the index 2, that is 96. Index 3, 45, index 4, 80, index 5, 74, and upper bound is not included. So 52 will not come here, right? So if I am giving the index 1 till 6, it means that I want the first index value till 5th index value. 6th index value will not be included. So colon here defines the range that we are defining an lower bound and an upper bound in which we want our slice to be of, right? So in this way, you can get a slice out of a 1D array, right? Now suppose I want a slice that should start from the starting but till index 5th. So we don't have to define 0 in the front. We can just left it empty. So empty, it will mean that it will have to start from the starting, right? So if I want to start it from the starting, I will not define 0 here. I will just keep it empty, right? So if I run this, you can see that it is starting from the starting up till index 5, 6 is not included, right? And in the similar fashion, if I want to start from a certain index, but I want to go till end, right? So after colon, I am going to just leave it empty. So what it will do is it will go up till end, right? If I run this, you can see that it has started from the index 6, that is 52, and then gotten till end, that is 32, right? So in this way, you can have random slices out of the array. So you can get one single value out of the array using the index, or you can have some slice out of it. In between slice, you can have the slice from the starting till some point, or you can have the starting from somewhere in the middle till the last, right? So you can have any type of slicing that you want from the array using the indexing part, right? So in the similar way that we have defined the slicing for a 1D array, we can also define the slicing for the 2D arrays also, right? So for a 2D array, I am going to define using randint function. I am going to take a 2D array. I am defining the size as 5 cross 5. So it means I want that my array should be a 5 cross 5 that consists of 5 rows and 5 columns. And the values will be ranging from 1 till 49. 50 is not included, right? So I have randomly defined a 2D array. Now I want some slices out of it, right? Suppose I want the single row out of it. So if I run this, so what it will give me if I want only row? So I will give just one value to it. It will start from indexing 0. So this is 0 row. This is the first row and this is the second row. So if I am going to give the index 2, it will give me the third row, right? So like this. And then suppose I want the second row and second column. So second row will be this one, right? And second column will be 0, 1, 2. It means it should give me a 36 value, right? So if I run this, so you can see that I have got a value of 36, right? So in the similar fashion, you can have the slices, like for example, if I run this one. So what it give me, I am giving a single bracket here, right? It means I want a row out of it, right? So inside that row also, I want to slice it, right? So what I am getting here, this is different. So inside this, we have to give the row and column, that which row and which column I want to slice it, right? So dividing between row and column, you have to use a comma here, right? So this comma divides between rows and columns. So in starting, we have to give the rows that we want, right? So I am not defining here anything. It means that it will take all the rows, right? And I am defining 2 here. That means it will take the second column, right? So it means this one is the second column and all the rows out of the second column. So this one is the second column. All the rows will be 37, 3, 36, 46, and 9. So So in this way, I am getting here values, right? So you can define anything here. If you want all the columns, you can define here colon after comma and give the values before comma, right? So you have to define the rows here, which row you want and which column you want, right? In the similar fashion, suppose I want 0 to 2, it means these first 0, 1, and 2 is not included, right? Upper bound is not included. So 0 and 1, I want these two rows, right? It means I want these two rows. And from these two rows, I want 0 to 2 columns. So it means I want 0, 1, 2 is not included. It means I want these values, right? These ones. So these four values, right? So if I'm going to run this, so you can see that I have got these four values, right? So you can slice any part out of it. You can define, you can separate the rows and columns by comma, and before comma, you can define how many rows you want, what range you want, and after comma, you can define the range of the columns. So in this way, you can have any slice or any index out of the arrays, right? Any doubt till here? Yes, anybody? Okay, moving on next, we are going to learn how we are going to iterate through the arrays. So iteration through array means that I want to read each element inside the array. For that, I have defined here an array that consists of characters. So you can have the numerical arrays also. You can have the character array also. You can have the string array also. You just have to define the elements inside the array and it will implicitly decide what type of array it is, right? So it will implicitly decide whether you are giving an integer array, you are getting a float array, you are getting a character array or a string array, right? You don't have to define it manually. So here I am giving the values as characters. A, B, and C. So these should be inside quotes so that it should know that these are the characters. So if I'm going to run this, let me insert an array here and let me show you this array that I have created. So if I, you can see here that it consists of the character values, right? So if I want to iterate through the all these values, we can use a for loop for that. So for, I can define a variable here that will iterate through inside this array. So for x in means inside this array. So we are going to print x. So first x will be a, then it will go back to b, then c. So if I run this, so you can see that it has iterated through every element of the array, right? In the similar fashion, we can also iterate through the 2D arrays. So if I insert here, so you can see my 2D array. So you can see we have a 2D array that consists of two rows and three columns. So if I run this, so you can see that it has iterated through each row. It has iterated row wise. First row, it has iterated in the first row, and second row, it has iterated in the second row. So in this way, you can iterate through 1D arrays or the 2D arrays also. So the details of the NumPy library are present here. This you can open this document, I'll show you. So this is the documentation of the NumPy library. So it consists of all the functions that are there. So you can see that it is powerful and used for n dimensional arrays. It is very fast and versatile that I already told you. And it is used for the numerical computations, right? It can be used with various platforms. It is very high performing. All the codes are written in C and C++. It is very easy to use and it is open source, right? I already told you all these things. So you can see this documentation. So here, if you go here inside the documentation, so you will get all the functions that are available here. So you can check these out, and if you want anything inside of it, you can learn that, right? There are various tutorials also available. So if you open this, right, you can have the tutorials for various types of arrays and everything, like for linear algebra or n dimensional arrays, right? So you can have this, and it will give you all the things that you need to learn, right? So you can visit the documentation, right, and see what type of other functions are available inside this NumPy library. I have told you the most used ones inside of the NumPy. So if you have any doubt, you can ask, try reading this documentation or try solving one or two examples that I have told you, and you can ask your doubts. And if anything is not clear that I explained, you can ask again.
You can unmute yourself if you have any doubt. I have given you the rights.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, these code are not working in Colab.
Which code is not working?
In Colab.
It should work. Have you imported the NumPy library? You have to first import the library, and then you can use the functionality.
Which library, ma'am?
NumPy library. Import NumPy, and then you can give any name to it, right? Import NumPy as np, and then you, first of all, run that line, and then you can use the functionality of the NumPy library.
Okay, ma'am. I will do try.
Yes, please try using importing first, right?
Okay.
Yes, any other student?
Anyone having any other doubt? So, Jeannie ma'am, can we end the session then?
We can just give 10 minutes so that they can try. We can end the session at 5.
Okay, ma'am.
Any student, any doubt, you can ask till 5, right?
And I have pasted the attendance link in the chat window. So do submit your attendance within next 10 to 15 minutes. And about your assignment grades, that will a file will be shared regarding the same in Google Classroom. No email will be circulated. A file will be uploaded in Google Classroom by today evening or tomorrow morning. Anyone having any doubt now? Ma'am, can we end the session then?
Yes, sure. Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Right. I hope everybody have submitted their attendance or have got the attendance link. I'm pasting again in the chat window. Do submit your attendance.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, I'm the one who is writing on the chat box. How can I my name be captured in yesterday's attendance? Because I attended the session, but unfortunately, before I was able to click on the link, you ended the session, the meeting.
So that's why I every day say you to copy the attendance link whenever I keep that over there. But
well,
you can could have pasted the attendance link. You just go through it once and see if it is open or not. I don't think it's open yet. Just click on it once and see if it is open or not.
Okay.
If it is not open, then I'll mark that manually. Don't worry about that.
It's not open. I've just clicked it, but it is not open. They said it is closed.
No issues. I'll mark that by myself. Rama, you submit today's attendance for yesterday. I'll mark that by myself. So I think we can end the meeting now. Do submit your attendance within the next 5 to 10 minutes. And your attendance, I'll consider that for yesterday, Rama. I'll mark that.
On 12 August, the same problem is...
Navroop, I'm not able to hear you. Your voice is breaking a lot.
Hello?
Yes.
I pasted a WhatsApp link. This is a student's WhatsApp. Adama, we paste the link every day in this group, and we can discuss even class problems. So, if you want to join this group, please go ahead. Thank you.
Navroop, you still have a doubt?
Navroop, copy the attendance link for today. Others won't work now.